So maybe we can start since you already started.
Ah. Okay, I'll just continue.
Yeah.
Okay. So yesterday we concluded the lecture by having obtained this equation, which was the equation for the smoothed fields, smoothed moments of the distribution of the Boltzmann equation, smoothed Boltzmann distribution. I distributed before I start, I distributed to the school some version of these notes, the first part, so you can probably find them on the website. So we smoothed the Boltzmann distribution within the following two equations for the long wavelength fields, where on the right of the momentum equation, there is this smoothed tensor induced by the short distance moments, where Kij was a kinetic long, it was a kinetic, the smoothed kinetic tensor minus the long wavelength, the same object made purely of long wavelength fields. And omega Wij was a sort of gravitational stress tensor. It was a pi g squared, and then there were schematic was omega L KK delta IJ minus DK phi long DK phi long delta IJ plus two similar terms where omega long IJ was the smoothing of an object quadratic in gravitational fields, which was di phi of x prime dj of phi of x prime minus the self energy di phi n of x di phi n of x. Okay, as we discussed, so this is what we got yesterday. And as we discussed also yesterday, this is not very useful. It's written because it contains short wavelength modes. These are short wavelength that contribute, since it's quadratic in short wavelength, also short wavelength field, it can have a long wavelength contribution, which will enter here. So it contributes a lot through here and here, and so it enters into the long wavelength equation. This is how short distance physics affect long distance physics at nonlinear level. So this is not very useful because we cannot solve analytically for the short modes, so as we say, it's not useful. However, as we also mentioned yesterday, we are going to compute the correlation function only along of along observables, like velocity of the long mode, or a long wavelength velocity, or a long wavelength density fluctuations. Our description is going to break down a short wavelength. So we can take the expectation value direct on the short modes directly at the level of the equation of motion. That is, we can substitute tau j lambda with the expectation value of tau j for or tau j lambda for a given long fixed, long mode, for a given long mode configuration, plus add a fluctuating component, which we call stochastic. So this is a stochastic component that accounts for the fact that on a given realization of the universe, imagine that there are many universes you can you are an experimentalist, create many universes. You can see many universes you are creating. Every time there will be, you get some short and long configuration, you compute this quantity. And so this is, in every universe will be slightly different. And what you get is, on every realization, is more or less equal to the expectation value that you get for a given long wavelength configuration plus the stochastic, which accounts for the difference for the difference that the given realization has with respect to the average. That is, not every time the short modes are going to be exactly the same, so the effect is not totally equal to the one that is on average, but there is a small difference. And the difference instead is small, which is this, the difference between the average is small as you go to longer and longer distances. Why? Because imagine that you are interested in very, very long wavelength modes. Inside a given wavelength, there are many, many, many isolated patches of order the nonlinear scale, 1 over k nonlinear, about 10 megaparsec. So each region here is a galaxy, we realized, another one here. These guys don't talk to each other very much. They're not very correlated. In fact, you can say that they're not at all correlated. And therefore, what happens for on a certain wavelength, on a given realization of the universe, is what happens due to the what happens in all these possible patches, which are many, many. And many, many, the longer we make this wavelength. And therefore, what you get on a given realization, since there are many, many independent patches, is what you get on average, up to a small fluctuation that goes to zero, because in the limit in which the number of independent patches, the number of galaxies inside your wavelength, goes to infinity. OK, so this object, this taking this expectation value is exactly, so this is called integrating out the short modes. This process. The short modes doing this. And it's what we do, for example, when we do quantum field theory, when we integrate out the short wavelength fluctuations in the path integral, keeping a certain configuration of the background field. It's called the background field method. OK, here there is a certain configuration of the long modes, and we're doing the average over the short modes. We're integrating the short modes. Here, the short modes are the galaxies, not some fancy small Planckian particle or 1 TeV particle. It's the galaxies, but it's identical. For us, the galaxies are infinitesimally small objects. OK, so it's what if you open the books, integrating out with background field methods, that's what we do, which is nothing but this. And what is this? This is equal to some some function which is very complicated, very complicated. Of what? So this expectation value, OK, let me just write. Plus, equal. There will be this stochastic term I will talk about later. Plus, the expectation value will be some very complicated function of everything of which I didn't take the expectation value, I didn't take the expectation value of. That is, on anything that is not a short modes. Because the short modes, I've taken the expectation value, so it doesn't depend anymore on the short modes. And what could be? It's everything that is allowed to depend on. For example, and this is a huge amount of stuff, Hubble, omega dark matter, the W of the dark energy, M, the mass of the dark matter, maybe the spin of the dark matter, very, very complicated object. At some point in this long list, there will be the energy, the how much dark matter is on the point, also how many baryons there are on that point. Well, for the moment, we are doing the universe solely with dark matter, so let's forget about baryons for the moment. But, and also, for example, how much is the gravitational force at that point and at that time, and many other stuff. Now, so this function is very complicated, as its name says, and it's apparently daunting. However, we notice what's happened. However, we notice the following: that we are interested instead on computing long wavelength fluctuations. So we're not going to compute tau j directly, but we're going to compute tau j hot 8 long wavelength. So by then you see that the only thing that depending on x is are these objects, okay? All the rest is constant, doesn't contribute to when I ask for long wavelength fluctuation. Contribute only to the zero mode, which we're not going to observe because we're doing short distances, okay, not the zero mode. So therefore, I can, so therefore, a long wave, but a long wavelength, at the long wavelength, rho Darmeta of x is the background rho Darmeta times 1 plus delta. We define this delta to be delta rho over rho at a given time. And this is much less than 1 at long wavelengths. So the background energy density does not depend on x. Okay, does not depend on x. And similarly for this object, at long wavelength is very small. It becomes very big at short wavelengths. So this means that since it's small, since fluctuations are small, we can Taylor expand. So this object is equal to some f0 of time, which doesn't contribute to any finite wavelength. It's just a zero mode, plus, for example, some coefficient 1 times delta rho Darmeta of x and t, plus another coefficient 2, Laplace of phi of x, plus C3, maybe quadratic order, delta. I will drop the subscript Darmeta, okay? So delta means Darmeta, so delta of x t square plus C4 di dj phi di dj phi and so on and so forth. Basically, I put everything that GR, general relativity, tells me it can depend on. For example, could I write here phi of x? Any guess? Yes, very good. Do you know the reason? Yeah, you can remove it with a local change of coordinate. You go to the local inertial frame where phi is zero. So phi is not locally observable. So this cannot depend on phi. Similarly, it cannot depend on gradient of phi, because gradient of phi you can set to zero with the same change of coordinate, also the first derivative of the gradient field, of the gravitational field. What can depend on is the second derivative of the gravitational field, because that's the Riemann tensor. That's what Einstein told us. In the local inertial frame, the physical effects are associated with the Riemann tensor, with the second derivative of the metric. And in the Newtonian limit, the second derivative of the metric is the second derivative of the Newtonian potential. So it cannot depend on phi, cannot depend on derivative of phi. Can it depend on the velocity at one location? Also not, because the velocity, again, if there is a uniform velocity, I can just go to the local frame, and I don't see the velocity, OK? It can depend on the gradients of the velocity. Yes, that can depend, because if there is a gradient of velocity, I see things, for example, are diluting away. So this is a very important step, because you see that this function, I put everything that can depend on GR generativity tells me can depend on. And then since I can Taylor expand, I can encode every single term that it can depend on. I'm dropping nothing. And this is why we believe that effective theory will be the right description of the system. Because if generativity is true, we're putting anything that it can depend on. No matter what dark matter is, no matter how fancy it is, strongly coupled, nuclear dark matter, whatever, is going to be just different coefficients for, as you change the dark matter model, you're going to get different coefficients here, but it's going to be the same. It's going to be encoded here. Sorry? Yeah, this we're going to see, exactly. This we're going to see in 10 minutes, okay? Let's. So, because right now, this is maybe nice, but, or maybe ugly, depends on the tastes, but what is super clear is, not super clear, how many terms should I keep? So I can write all the terms, but if I need to keep infinite term, okay, it's pretty useless. Okay, so let's see. First, let me give you a few comments. Let me get sure I said everything. Okay, so there is an improvement we need to do on these formulas, because we need to do the most general dependence you can have with the symmetries of the problem, which is just general relativity. So clearly, in the universe is not untranslation invariant, right? Things change with time. So all coefficients should be time dependent. But this is not enough. In fact, what we're doing here, we're asking ourselves, there is some small clump of dark matter here, maybe an halo, 10 halos, okay? And we're asking how it can depend all the short distance power here, whatever, how it depends on the long wavelength fields. So now, the formation time, so for example, this expression tells us that, okay, the region that fell into the halo, in an halo that you studied last week with the mass function, in an halo fell from some neighboring region of a size of order canolinea, so 1 over canolinea. In fact, canolinea is exactly the distance two dark matter particles could have traveled to each other, so that's exactly over the canolinea. And we say, okay, you have to ask, and then there's some long wavelength fluctuation of rho, for example, so you say, okay, it depends maybe on delta rho over rho, maybe there is some Laplacian of phi, some tidal tensor, maybe I get di, dj, phi, here there is, and clearly, this, if I have a point here, I can approximate di, dj, phi here of x as, call this point x1. So the idj phi of x, since I'm interested only in the idj phi of this region, okay, let me just do it for delta of x. There could be delta of x. Say that this is delta of x. And I want to evaluate, and what matters is delta of x of this region, of a series of order k nonlinear. Since k nonlinear is much smaller, much shorter wavelength than the wavelength of our guy, of k, then delta of x is more or less equal to delta of the point of interest plus the derivative of delta x1 in the range of distances that I care about, which is 1 over k nonlinear. And then maybe if I'm, then there is a correction, which is a d2 delta over k nonlinear square, and so on and so forth. So we see that we don't need just to put the field. In general, the configuration of delta in all this region will matter, but the configuration of delta in all this region is well given by a Taylor expansion in the derivatives around the origin, which is the origin where the point under consideration is. So here we should add also, therefore, derivative suppressed by what? Suppressed by k nonlinear, the range of interest. Where I care, derivative over k nonlinear of delta of x, or derivative over k nonlinear, for example, of di dj phi, maybe times derivative over k nonlinear. Sorry, derivative over k nonlinear, sorry, dl, maybe dl, di dj phi, and things like that. So, in general, here I should include in the function, which was very complicated, so we go on the second line, all derivative divided by suppressed by special derivative by suppressed by Kenon linear. Okay, so we have a derivative expansion. This begins to show you your companion what was kind of the suppression that these terms have, because the more you see, each derivative is going to be a small correction as long as this is going to be evaluated. We're going to interest in the low wavelength, right? So derivative of a long wavelength field goes like k over Kenon linear, counts like Kenon linear. So this expansion is an expansion in powers over Kenon linear, and the next term is smaller than the first one if k is less than Kenon linear. So clearly, this expansion that we're doing is going to break down a k over the Kenon linear, but it's going to be very rapidly convergent if k is much less than Kenon linear. Okay. Now, if you carefully notice what you learned about last week about the mass function, you realize that actually the time it takes an halo to form. Okay, so this is done. Next, we have to do one more improvement. You realize that the time it takes an halo to form is not very, very rough, very, very fast. It's not. The time scale it forms is about an Hubble time. And during this Hubble time, the field have gone a bit, the certain point that became the halo has gone a bit around, has traveled some distance. And in particular, the long wavelength field that affect the formation of the halo have changed, because the time scale of the long fields, time scale of long fields, is of order Hubble. How do we know that? You remember last week, Ravi explained that the linear solution, for example, in a universe filled with dark matter, but to a good approximation, it doesn't change much, is AOT times the initial linear perturbation, goes like this, so it's proportional to this. A function of K times AOT, and so delta dot over delta on the linear solution goes like K, goes like Hubble. And this is a long field. This is a linear solution. So this will be the long field. The long field changes by order one in Hubble time. But also the shear fluctuation that collapses into this black hole takes an Hubble time to fall. So when I write this formula, the halo's mass will depend on rho at the time of observation, or also the time, maybe an Hubble time earlier, half an Hubble time earlier. And therefore, should I put here rho at the current time or rho at x at t minus an Hubble time? Clearly, in general, it will depend on all these times, all the times that during which the formation of the black hole occurred. So we improve the formula by saying that actually this very complicated function not only contains all this field, but evaluated on the path like cone. All this field must be taken on the path like cone of the point. But since the object, but the matter did not move much, right? It did not move much. It just took a long time to form, but things didn't move. So the path like coin is actually is maybe like the past tube of radius Kenon linear to the minus one, but Hubble, order Hubble length, Hubble inverse length, time length. So it's a tube that extends in time over the Hubble time and only stretches in the special direction of Kenon linear. So therefore, when I take this complicated formula and I begin to tell respond, I should actually evaluate all this field on the past, like cone. So this formula becomes Oops. Okay, sorry. F. So now, F very complicated, F very complicated. When I try to expand, therefore, I need to include all earlier times, so it becomes integral over some t prime up to time t. And each coefficient is going to be a function of t prime. So it will be some kernel 1, for example, between t and t prime, times, for example, Laplacian of phi at time t prime, and at the location x prime of x, where the point that ended up here at x was at the time t prime. At time t prime, x was the time x prime of x at time t prime, was here at the point. So we have to write the dependence on the field at the location. So we call this x fluid of x. And this kernel tells us that if you put is how much the Laplacian of phi at time t prime affects the tau ij at time t. At time t. So the all t primes matter, and plus again, comma, plus another kernel, for example, tt prime. Kernel 2, maybe for example d2 phi square of x fluid t prime again, and so on and so forth. Okay. So this is the most general formula compatible with the symmetry of the problem. Yes? So we're trying to write an equation. Thank you. Yeah, please ask a question. Sorry, I forgot. So we're trying to find, remember that we're trying to find an equation for the long wavelength mode. But since short wavelength mode affects long wavelength modes and nonlinear level, maybe I should explain this. That is, if you take a field of x and you take it quadratic, you take the long wavelength energy, you go to Fourier space, it's a certain wave number k. Okay, this is equal to the integrand d3k, et3x, e to the ikx, phi of x squared. This is, but the problem of Fourier transform is the convolution of the two Fourier transforms, so of phi of k minus q, phi of q. So all q's that goes to infinity contribute. This is non-zero for k goes to infinity. So product of short wavelength field contributes a long wavelength. So this means that at nonlinear level, short wavelength fields affect long wavelength fields. Okay, therefore, if you want to write an equation for the long fields, you need to know something about the short fields. Okay, so what they do is this tau j. One second, I'll finish this and then, I didn't finish it, but. Bear? How many? How many you're asking? Okay, yeah, these are all bare. I'll describe the normalization end of this class or maybe next. We're gonna see all of this next, end of this class, next class. The cutoff will be of order k nonlinear, but the result will be cutoff independent. Can you ask me the same question when we talk about this? Yes, because it's like in quantum electrodynamics. First you write the equation, and then you study the normalization. And then you study the normalization, right? We do two steps. Yes, we're going to do this later, so I'll discuss later. But let me anticipate the answer, but I cannot have time now to do it completely. But let me just say that in QA, quantum electrodynamics, first you were Maxwell Lagrangian, and then we study renormalization later, right? So we're going to do the same. First we write the equation, and now we're writing the equation. And then later. Yeah, to finish your answer. Okay, so we saw that the tau j, how short modes affect long distances is through tau j. Okay, but this tau j, we need to write, know what it is. And it's very complicated to know what it is. That's what, in a sense, what when you study the mass function, you are trying to understand what it is. But that's it's very complicated, and it's very hard to be extremely precise. But this is an extremely precise answer. That is, everything that general relativity can tell us it can do is this. And since I'm interested in the long wavelength, the fluctuations are very small, so I begin to Taylor expand. But the most generic Taylor expansion is this one. Okay. Now, you might still be slightly unhappy by the fact that in principle there are infinite terms in this Taylor expansion. Okay, but then we will see later that for a precision at a given or for a given precision of the calculation, I will need only a few terms. So the number of terms we need is small or it's finite given the precision that we want to reach. So and this we're going to see later. So that will be the philosophy. Okay. Let me see, check. So this is the crucial passage why the effective field theory is right? Because it's right in the most general dependence on the Chalmers that we are. At the cost of such coefficients, we are general. Now, notice that these are not just coefficients. These are time-dependent kernel. That is, this dependence on two times. Okay. For example, this is not so unfamiliar. For example, as I told you, we're going to do something similar to electric materials. And remember, in the electrics, you had the electric cost, which was a function of omega, which, for example, I don't remember precisely, but the polarizability as a function of omega in Fourier space was epsilon of omega times the electric field of omega, which in real space means that P of t is the integral in dt prime of the polarizability between t and minus t prime, E of t prime. That is, these terms are the analogous of, in the dielectric material, or the dielectric constants. Now, the fact that they depend on omega means that in real space, they depend on their kernel, the function of time. And the answer you see, also in dielectric material, the answer is not local in time. The answer, the polarization at time t depends on the electric field at time t prime. Here, the stress tensor at time t, this is at time t, depends on the tidal tensor at time t prime. Now, the only difference is that since in electromagnetism, time translation is a symmetry, this epsilon can depend only on t minus t prime, only the difference in time. Here, because time translation is broken, it's actually is t minus t prime comma t. So it depends independent of t and t prime. So this is not so unfamiliar. But the statement that this object depends, tau j depends on the field at earlier times is, we call it non-locality in time. That is, the short wavelength object do not depend locally in time on the long one, on the long ones. But we have locality space. That is, the short wavelength object depends on the field at the same location or in a very nearby of the same location, where the location is the location of the field that he had at time t prime. I mean, this X fluid can be given a I mean, I can give you an expression for X fluid. X fluid depends on X and T prime. It's nothing but X minus the velocity, the path he did from T prime to T. Okay, so this is the expectation value of the effective stress tensor. Rather complicated, but not infinitely complicated, okay? I mean, as you will see, the same structure, I mean, this is described Darmetter-Hellow with arbitrary precision, okay? So it couldn't be too simple, okay? Please ask questions, eh? I mean, it's good. Okay. Now, the only thing I need to define is delta tau. Okay, what is delta tau? Delta tau, as we said, was the difference between on a certain region of size of order k, inverse, between the expectation value and what happens really true in reality in a given realization because of the Schur modes. So delta tau is a stochastic field that has is extremely localized correlation function. That is, delta tau is something which has, expectation value zero. In fact, it's the difference between the field and the expectation value. And correlation functions, a variance, or higher point function, which are, however, localized in space. We can put arbitrary ones. So two objects are correlated only if they find each in on top of each other, otherwise they're uncorrelated. And the size is canon linear cube. Okay, so this defines the theory. And later we're gonna solve for it. Okay. It is interesting, however, to get some familiarity. Wow. Is the pace good or I'm going too slow? Can you shake your hand if I'm going too slow? No, shake your head, sorry. I'm going too slow? No, like this. Okay, fine. Okay. I'm going too fast? No, fast it's okay, no, okay. Ah, okay, so I will not go faster. Okay, so just to gain intuition, okay, let me skip this part, and let me just talk about the perturbation theory, how to do with this part. So now we have the equation. Now we have equations. Let us solve for them. So this is the second section of the notes. I mean, if I will have time, I'll come back to the part I skipped of session one, how to do perturbation theory with this theory. And renormalization. Okay. Yes. I think within the fatty theory, this is the only answer, because anything smaller than canon linear is local. So for us, canon linear is a pixel. And this is and if there is a correlation between two different pixels, it's because of the long mode. But then the long mode is in the theory, then it's not been taken the expectation value over. Yeah. Yes. This answer for the fatty theory is equivalent to having small correlation of the size of order canon linear, the correlation length of order canon linear. It doesn't make any difference for us. It's just degenerate with the counter terms. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Okay, how we do perturbation theory? So we got now we got some equations, which has, I repeat. So we have equations. What are them? Laplacian of phi. This one is Poisson equation. Equal for our equation for the long modes. X square Rolong, sorry, delta long. This is the how perturbations in gravitational field are affected by the perturbation in the energy density. Then I rewrite the continuity equation. And then the momentum equation. Equal, and then there is the object that we drew before. Where for this, we have the form of you look there. Okay? For that, we look there. So this is a function of delta tau and all the Laplacian of phi long, blah, 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 blah. Okay? Now, you should notice, it's important to notice that this equation contains all the long modes. The short modes have gone, okay? Have gone because the short modes enter in tau j and have substituted them with these kernels. So at the cost of the coefficient, now this equation don't contain any long mode. So can be solved in the long mode. I mean, they're solvable. All the I want to solve for the long modes, they are closed. They contain all the long modes, we can solve them. Okay, let's start to solve them. Now you can see that they are nonlinear. For example, this is a nonlinear term. This is a nonlinear term because so we're interested in expansion. So we're interested in small fluctuations. It's not very interested. Sorry. At k less than k nonlinear, which is where we can doing fluctuations are small. Where we're focusing. Fluctuations are small. So it's very intuitive that probably a good way to solve this equation is to solve Taylor expanding in the smallest of the fluctuations. Okay. So remember that, by the way, that rho long is 1 plus delta long times rho background. So rho long contains the fluctuation, delta rho over rho, which we call delta. So it's very intuitive that we're going to solve them iteratively. In particular, in fact, just to see ourselves that is a that it is nonlinear. So let me drop for a moment the terms that come from tau j. So for the moment, we neglect the tau j. Okay, we do if it wasn't there. We can remember to put it back later. And the equation takes the following. We go, the equation takes the following. A h delta L prime plus, sorry. Let me first say one thing, sorry. From this equation, one can take the equation of motion for the vorticity. Vorticity, it is defined as omega long I equal epsilon ijk dj of vk. Now, you see, if you take the equation for momentum, you take a dj and then contract with epsilon ijk, you're going to get an equation for omega, which is the following, d in dt plus h, okay, minus, okay, forgetting the stress tensor, w I long equal epsilon I j k dj 1 over a epsilon k mn vlm m omega n. Okay, now, one sees that we know that modes, as you studied with Ravi, fluctuations are constant inside the Hubble scale, and then as time goes on, they become shorter than Hubble, and they start to grow. But they start very, very small, and then start to grow. So at early times, when I solve this equation, the nonlinear terms, v is a small perturbation, because in an homogeneous universe, velocity is zero. So this is small at early times. And the solution to this term is that w omega, the vorticity goes to zero. So vorticity goes to zero in the linear regime. It's quickly driven to zero. And then there is a nonlinear correction, but the nonlinear correction is proportional to omega square as well, which is small. So the solution is driven to zero. So omega IL is quickly driven to zero. So in this equation, I neglected the effect of the stress tensor, which means that neglecting the stress tensor, the vorticity is going to zero. Now, we're going to see that the stress tensor actually can create some vorticity, but the vorticity is a small effect. So the stress tensor will be always an important but small effect. So which means that we can base our perturbation theory setting the vorticity to zero. Okay? So we can set to zero, which means if there is no vorticity, that all the information of the velocity is equivalent to the information of theta, which is di of vi, okay? Because vi is equal to di of Laplacian of theta. This is wrong if there is vorticity, but it's correct if there is no vorticity. So our equation, so therefore all v here, whenever there is v here, at a very high order in perturbation theory, this is correct. V is di over Laplacian of theta. Okay, so the equation that we get are the following. So we can write them as A curly H delta prime long plus theta long equal minus integrand d3q. Okay, I'll drop 2 pi cube, you can find them in the notes. Alpha q k minus q times delta long of q theta long of k minus q. This is the continuity equation. And the other one is a h theta prime long plus h theta long. This is the momentum equation. This is the force of gravity. And then there is nonlinear term coming from the v grad v there, which is minus d3q beta q k minus q theta long of k minus q theta long of q. Okay, you see that, and these are all fields evaluated at k. Prime means d in dA, and h is equal to 1 over a d a in d tau, where tau is conformal time. So d tau a is dt over a. Okay, so this is the equation, where one can directly derive the alpha k of q of kq is equal to k plus q dot k over k square, and beta of kq is equal to k plus q square k dot q over 2q square k square. Okay, so this equation are nothing but the writing in Fourier space this equation. And you can see that the fact that they are non-linear, in particular there are quadratic terms, implies that there are terms which involve convolution of fields. Because the Fourier transform of a product is the convolution of the Fourier transforms. Okay, we're going to solve them in perturbation theory. That is a linear level. We're interested in long wavelength, k much less than k non-linear. So delta long, v long, phi long, also Laplacian of phi long, which is delta long, phi long, everything is very, very small in the relevant units. So, sorry, which are all dimensionless. So now we're going to solve them. There is a linear equation, delta prime long plus theta long equals zero, and then okay, there is AH, and then there is AH theta long prime plus H theta long plus 3/2 A0 square omega meter over A delta long equals zero. And these are all functions of K and A. Okay, all the variables are functions of K and A. And the solution, this you solved the last week with Ravi. Or if you don't remember, you plug it in Mathematica. That's an easy trick. And the solution reads the following. The delta linear, and we call one the linear, long of K and A is equal to a growth factor D of A over the growth factor at time zero. A zero means present time. Times a stochastic variable, which we call delta S long of K, where delta S long of K prime. This is a Gaussian variable, so only two-point function is present. And the two-point function is equal to 2 pi cube delta 3 of k plus k prime times the initial power spectrum of dark matter. Ah, by the way, it's been normalized. This is the power spectrum at time is zero, but it's the linear one. So this is the linearly evolved. The initial power spectrum, linearly evolved, taken at present time, to present time, to A0. So the shape of P11 of K0 is this one. This is K, this is P11 of K0. Let me just plot KQ P11 of K0, P11 of A0. It's a function that goes a bit like this, and it has a break at about 10 to the minus 2 H inverse megaparsec. That's a meta radiation equality. And then it becomes over the one around point, I mean, around some number between, somewhere between 0.1 and 1. Between 0.1 and 1, the fluctuation becomes over the one. So if I focus on long wavelength, KQ POK, which is how much are the fluctuations, are small. That's our basis of the idea why we started this. Okay, this is the linear solution. How do we go find the nonlinear solution? Please ask questions, eh? I mean, Okay, let's do the second order solution. Second order. How are we going to solve the second order? Well, you see that the equation has a linear structure, which are this term here. And then on the right, there are quadratic terms. So if you solve perturbatively, means that what we're going to do is that is like if we have, we're going to plug back the linear solution here and solve for the second order solution. That is, we write delta of k and a as the linear solution of k and a plus a quadratic solution per k and a, and so on and so forth, and similarly for theta. And if you, and the equation satisfied for delta 1 is this one. This is the equation for delta 1. These are all ones. You can put all ones because it's the equation for the one, for the linear field. And the equation for the quadratic field is this equation, where here I put the quadratic field, the second on the field. And here, if I substitute that expression and I want to go up to second order, the only ones terms that are surviving are these ones. But then you see, because if I put 2, 1 here, the overall fluctuation is of order, is cubic. Indeed, sorry, maybe I should say that delta 2, we assume that delta 2 is of order delta 1 square. That is, it's an iterative solution delta. Is this clear? Okay. So, you see that the second order solution, the equation for the second order variable, has the following structure. There is some complicated differential equation, differential operator, acting on a variable, delta 2, theta 2, doesn't matter. And equal, now, you see, I know the solution for delta 1. This is already solved. So on the right-hand side, there is something that is known. Some function of k of x and t, of k and t, or a. So the solution to this kind of equation means that the second order, it means that delta 2 is given by the integral of x and t, you give the integral over all space-time point of the Greek function between the retarded Greek function between nx and x prime of the source evaluated at space-time x prime. So these are four variables. They're four-dimensional variables. So that's the way. That's the way we solve a differential operator on a function equal some known term. And in particular, the Greek function satisfies the following equation. The same differential operator on the retarded Greek function, the differential operator with respect to variable x, the retarded Greek function is between x and x prime, is equal to delta 4 of x mu minus x prime mu. That is, the Greek function is the solution to the problem of the differential operator on the Greek function equal delta 4, where with some boundary condition. With boundary conditions. Okay. In particular, okay, let's apply this logic to the problem at hand. Okay, and in particular, in our problem, the Greek function, the differential equation, okay, the Greek function satisfies a differential equation. These are two first-order differential equation, prime, prime, which I can combine in one single second-order differential equation. And the second order differential equation for the Greek function, the equation for the Greek functions, for Green function, Green's function, is the following. Basically, it takes one can take the a derivative on the second equation and substitute theta with, simply substitute theta with delta prime. So we get the following equation. Minus a square h square. Second derivative with respect to the scale factor of g a prime. So there is a different Greek function for each Fourier mode. So I can write this operator, the one we wrote there, you can write it in Fourier space. And there is a different Greek function for each Fourier mode. But the k, since the equation is linear, k just goes along for the ride. It doesn't matter. And then there is minus a multiplying 2 a square of a plus a h h prime. I mean, these are all functions of a, yeah? Times dA of g of a prime plus 3 omega meter a0 square over 2a g a prime. I mean, it depends on k, but k, in principle, depends on k. But you see, I mean, in principle, depends on k. But we see that there are no k in the equations, in the equation, equal delta a prime. OK, so this is the differential equation for the Greek function. And the boundary conditions are g a prime, g retarded is always the retarded Greek function. So the, all Greek functions satisfy the same differential equation. What we mean by retarded are the following boundary conditions associated to this differential equation. G retarded equals 0 for a less than a prime. So this is the Greek function that tells us the effect at time a of a source at times a prime. J is the source. And clearly it's retarded because there is no effect in the past from a source put in the future. OK, now for lambda CDM, this solution you can solve it exactly. It's some hypergeometric function that you can get it by putting it into Mathematica, for example, and solve it or some other, or opening some book of differential equation. It doesn't matter. It's some term. But you can see that given that there is no k in the equation, then the Greek function will not depend on k. And this is important. So this means that the effect for each k, the effect at the source at times a prime at time a is independent of k. It's the same for every k, for every mode. OK, so now that we have the Greek function, we plug back here, and we get the second order solution for delta 2. Delta 2 long of ka is some slightly complicated expression, which I write it once for completeness, also for demystification. It is, there is the integral of the Greek function up to a from 0 of the Greek function between a and a tilde square, h of a tilde, d prime of a tilde square, times 2 times the integral d3q of beta of qk minus q. And then there is delta s of q, delta s of k minus q. Delta s is this exactly Gaussian variable whose stupid function is this. OK, plus integral up to a of dA tilde of g a tilde times 2 a tilde square h square of a tilde, the prime of a tilde square plus 3a0 omega m d a tilde square over a tilde times integral in d3q of the other interaction, alpha of k minus q of delta s of k minus q times delta s of q. Okay, so this is the solution, a second order. There are, you see, there are two terms, there is alpha and beta, so there are, in a sense, two sources. And the Gris function multiplies both, but with different independent coefficients. So this is alpha and beta, and this is one time dependent coefficient multiplying the Gris function, and this is a different time dependent coefficient multiplying the same Gris function. I could have factorized the Gris function in front of everybody, because indeed the result is the Gris function acting on the total source. But this structure is useful because you can see that the solution has a k-dependent term, but not depending on A. And this term is doesn't depend on A or k and q, but depends only on A and A prime. So as we saw here, the integral in Q is equivalent to integral in space. So the response to the source should have been an integral in space and in time. And this is the integral in time, and this is the integral in space, but the two integrals factorize. You can do the integral in time, and then you can do separately the integral in space. And this is due to the fact that the Gris function is k-independent. Okay. Now, this is a very useful simplification. One can notice there is a useful simplification that now we're going to use. So similarly, one can find the third order solution. Again, one other equation for delta 3, delta 3 plus theta delta 3 equal the source, which now will contain delta L2 theta L1 plus also delta L1 theta L2, and one iterates. Okay? I give you a reference where you can find the third order solution in the notes, but I will not write it. Yes? Yes, okay, this is exactly. We're gonna. Okay, the quick answer is that you see by special that each delta, you see, tau was delta plus delta square plus delta cube. Since delta is small, the second order term is smaller than the first. So it shouldn't matter as much as the first because it's smaller. So if I'm not gonna be very precise, probably I can neglect the second order term and keep only the first term. Okay, that's the logic. And in fact, we will see in a second that for each order in which I go in the calculation, there is a certain number of terms I keep in tau. And this is required by renormalization. In fact, we're going to do the we will see experimentally in the calculation. I mean, I think it's simple to see it in the calculation. Then there will be a general rule. Okay, so summarizing the solution. At our solution has the following form. So there is a very useful simplification. That is, to a very good approximation, this integral in time can be done. And they take the very, 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 the following simple form. Delta 2 of k and a is equal to d of a square. Remember, the linear solution was going like d of a over a 0 to the 1. Here it goes simply to the square. And then the integral d3q1, d3q2 of delta 3 of k minus q1 minus q2 times F2 of Q1, Q2, delta 1 of Q1 A0, delta 2, delta 1 of Q2 A0, and similarly delta 3 of K and A is D of A Q. So, by the way, notice that we collapsed the sum of those two terms into one term, whose prefactor is this one, simply the growth factor square, and this F2 is some simple function. F2, I mean, schematically, is 1 D plus Q dot K over Q square, things like this, okay? Nothing, some function of K and Q with dot products. You can find it in the reference, but it's some simple polynomial function, I mean, fractional function. And the cubic, similarly, the cubic, it very nicely goes like the cube, and now I have three linear fluctuations. F3 of Q1, Q2, Q3. Delta 1 of Q1. Let's say that when I don't put the time variable means that it's the present time. Delta 1 of Q2, delta 1 of Q3. So, okay, the solution takes the following rather simple form. In other words, we can do explicitly the integral in time. This was one time integral, this was two time integrals, and we're left with simply the integral in space. Okay, now I can begin to compute the nonlinear correction to the two-point function. So the power spectrum, P of K, is the correlation function of, let me check that I didn't skip anything, of delta K, and delta is sum over n of delta n times sum over m of delta m. Okay. And we're working, assuming that delta is small. Indeed, we know that we were working only along wavelengths. So, and in fact, we computed only up to cubic order. So this term receives contribution from delta 1, delta 1. So remember that this is OK. Is k prime k. So there was delta 1, which is the linear power spectrum. This is P11. This is delta function of k plus k prime, P11 of k. But then if I go to the quartic orders in delta, I get one term which is delta 2, delta 2, okay, k k prime. Okay, and apart, this I call it delta 3 of k plus k prime. The delta 3 is the Hilbert translation invariant. The universe is translation invariant. It's not time translation invariant, but it's spatial translation invariant. And this we call it P22 of k. P22 because I'm taking 2, 2 here. And then there is delta 3. I can take the third order on one side, the linear order in the other side. And this I call it delta function of k plus k prime, p 3 1, and there is another term which is delta 1, delta 3, which is p 1 3. Okay, so I get the sum of three different terms. Two of them are trivially related by permutation. And each one, what it is? Well, I basically, for example, P22, I write two terms of this guy, and I remember that these are Gaussian variables. So I take the expectation value. So let me derive the diagram. Okay, I'll just write this, and then I'll continue next time. So let's write down what is the form. Okay, how do you compute P22? So P22 is the expectation value, as we said, delta 2, delta 2. So we plug the stuff in, so we get dA over dA0 to the fourth. Then we get integrand dQ1, dQ2, then dq1 prime, dq2 prime, f2 of q1, q2, f2 of q1 prime, q2 prime. Then I get delta of q1, delta of q2. These are all delta linear. Delta q1 prime, delta q2 prime, linear. And now I take the expectation value of this object. But the expectation value, these are all numbers. So the expectation value is here. Now these are Gaussian variable. These are Gaussian. So since they're Gaussian, this term here, I use Weak theorem. I do all the possible contractions. So I can contract this with this, or this with this. This with this, and also I can do the other contraction. When I take the expectation value, this with, let me do this with this and this with this. So this is equal to, this one gives me delta 3 of Q1 plus Q1 prime, P11 of Q1, and the other gives me delta 3 of Q2 plus Q2 prime, P11, sorry, this of Q1, this of Q2. Now, when I plug this expectation value here, the Q1 prime and Q2 prime eliminate. I can do the Q1 prime and Q2 prime integral, setting Q1 prime equal to Q2 prime. And so this is equal to dA over dA0 squared integral in D3. Sorry, here I forgot the delta function of k minus q1 minus q2 times delta of k minus q1 prime minus q2 prime. So this becomes integral. So these two delta function kill two of these integral. One of these, one can be killed, kills, the, for example, the q2 integral, and the other remains, gives me delta 3 of k plus k prime, delta function momentum conservation, and then I get integral in dq of f2 of k minus q, q square, p11 of q, p11 of k minus q. So this is the result of p22. And similarly, there is an analogous result for P31. OK, tomorrow we're going to see how, or next class, which I think is Thursday. I mean, I suggest you go through the algebra, I mean, quickly algebra yourself, the logic yourself. And in the next class, we're going to evaluate these integrals and see what is the result. And then you will see that the stress tensor is essential to get a result that makes sense and actually is correct. Okay. One question. If you think I'm going too slow or too fast, please come to me down here privately, you tell me, so that I can adjust a bit the pace. Or if it's fine, also just tell me it's fine. Okay. Thank you.